Hi, everyone. My name is Tin Lorica. I use they, them pronouns. I'm a queer Filipinx settler on the unceded territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh peoples. I'm a poet and also a stand-up comedian, although not much that second part these days. And I just came out with a poetry chapbook called Soft Armor through Rahilas Ghost Press. Thank you for having me.
All right. Thank you, Tin. And now we will go to Juliane. Did I pronounce that right, Juliane? Okay, great.
Yeah, hi, everyone. Thank you for having me at the Fraser Valley Lit Festival. Thank you, Andrea, for inviting me. I live in Vancouver and on the lands of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh people, and for that I'm grateful. I want to present myself today as a poet. I have a book, 100 Days, out, and a couple of chapbooks. One is called Sublime Lost Words that you can find online for free, published by Elephant Press. And the other one is called Gauntlet that came out last year, 2019. Right now, I'm the writer in residence for SFU. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Juliane. And now next on my screen is Selina.
Tanse, hello. Selina Nitsiga-san. So, hi, my name is Selina. I'm a white settler and Nehiao poet. My pronouns are she, her. I'm also on the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh people. It's been really tough the last couple weeks, but I've been really enjoying walks and feeling a lot of like gratitude to be a guest on these lands. And yeah, I have a book coming out in the spring for poetry called Undoing Hours with Nightwood Press. And my primary genre is poetry. So I'm very curious to dive into this panel on landscapes of horror. I'm really curious to see what we all have come up with. And yeah, thank you to the festival for inviting me.
Right on. Thank you, Selina. It's nice to hear Cree. Echoes Annie. And then Sam, last but not least.
Thank you so much for having me, David, and the festival. And I feel woefully out of my depth among all of you. My name is Sam Wiebe, and I write a detective series which is set in Vancouver, which is where I lived up until 4 weeks ago. I've just moved to New Westminster. I have just put out a book called Never Going Back, which is a heist novel for kids, as silly as that sounds. Yeah, just really, really happy to be here.
Okay. Doesn't sound silly at all. I like that as writers, I love that we can stretch different genres to our own imaginations. I mean, that's part of the fun of writing, isn't it? It's taking these different forms and seeing what we can do with them that's new and unique. And I think that's something that we'll probably see in some of the work that we've done for landscapes of horror, which I think it's interesting because, you know, we have three poets here. To me, poetry is a landscape of horror. To me, it's the thing that I am least skilled at. But at the same time, I love poetry. I have a great respect for poets. It's an incredibly difficult form to write it, but I love it. I like trying to write it. So it'll be kind of fun to see how, you know, we mesh poetry with a theme like this. Just a little bit more about myself, just as a moderator. Just to let everybody know who's watching out there. I'm getting through like a bout of laryngitis that has lasted about a month. So I'm going to try and talk, even though I'm supposed to be a moderator, as little as I can, because my voice will start to crack after a little bit. But we have great panelists here who I think will have some great discussions. And I think my job is really is just to kickstart it and see where we go. So I'm from Winnipeg. My home community is Norway House Cree Nation. I am on Treaty One land right now, which is the homeland of the Métis. and traditional territories of the Anishinaabe, Cree, Dene peoples, not Dene peoples. Anyway, and so I think it's nice to acknowledge the territories that we are coming from and living on. I assume now we have probably three poems and one prose work, but maybe we could spend 3 to 4 minutes each. If you have poems, just read your poem. But I think people would like to hear what you've written for these pieces. So why don't we just go around again and take a few minutes each. And Sam, if your piece is a bit longer, maybe just take 3 to 4 minutes and read an excerpt. But we can read our pieces and then get into a discussion. So let's go clockwise again, and we'll go down to Tin.
Okay. I feel like I did a lot more research in this poem, more than actually writing the poem, but yeah, I can definitely go through the whole 3 to 4 minutes. It's just pretty short. And I'm just reading it, like I don't need to explain it or anything. Okay, so this poem is called Kaladua. Every night, I brace myself for signs of human trespass in my home. The fifth step on the stairs is a dead giveaway, creaks only with the weight of a whole person. When the moon is scarce, I wait until the early dawn when it is safe to sleep again. No one ever comes. Sometimes I lay awake and there is Maria with the long black hair, eerily crooning, a ding-ko-pong, sing-sing, wandering around a hasting sunrise street. But how did she get here? I interrogate the noise with cold hands, carefully feel the vibrations of each versus syllable in the floorboards. Her voice trails in and out as she passes heritage homes, none of which are hers. Her body, a noiseless, legless silhouette, only her barren song making its way directly underneath my window. As if to prophesy once again that the Spanish are coming, the Americans are coming, the Japanese are coming, and that there are no poet laureates among the riverbank people. Thank you.
All right, very nice. Yes, very nice. Thank you, Tin. Yeah, really beautiful piece. Beautiful in a landscape of horror, which is it's interesting, we'll get into this a little bit, but like, I think, you know, infusing that kind of theme of horror and also incorporating elements from your own cultural background is, you know, pretty, I think a pretty interesting thing to do. Research is usually, can be, writing is probably a very small percentage of what we do as writers. So you see this much and we do probably this much. So I'll write into that a little bit too. But, hello?
We lost Dave.
Oh, am I here? Did you get me? Am I here? Okay. Okay, Juliane, are you ready to share your piece?
Sure. Sorry we lost you. You were saying something, David, and I wish we could have caught it.
Sorry. Yeah. Oh, I was just going to say, yeah, so very sorry about that. I must have a kid who's streaming something. yeah, let's hear your piece, Juliane.
Okay, I do need to say thank you to Tin for yours. Absolutely beautiful, and I think about the use of beauty in writing about horrific situations, or and how beauty can be a tool to bring us in as readers. Mine is a little bit more than 3 minutes, so, and I do need to say something about it. But it's also not the poem that I wrote, because I wrote that not thinking about landscape of horror, even though it is a constant landscape of horror that we live in right now, with its history and presence of the afterlife of slavery and anti-Black racism and anti-Indigenous racism and genocide and all that. We don't need to make it up, this horror, we live it. But this piece is from a section of work I was doing called Stories from the Dry Season. And it's about the thousands of Acholi children who were kidnapped by the Lord's Resistance Army. And so this is an imagined voice speaking back to us who were not kidnapped. That's from Northern Uganda from 1987 to 2007. That's how long the war was. So I'll try and accept it so it's not too long, okay?
Don't feel restrained by 3 minutes, though. Like, you know, it's just a guideline. We have an hour and a half, so we're, you know, we're good.
Okay. Just as well we were taken from our schooling, the land would not provide a script. People fell where they fell, they bled where they bled. Rain was a drizzle like a tease, all ferocious when it was. And then blood and pain soaked into the earth, or the sun baked it hard, hard, hard into a stone that could not be read as gravestone markers. Just as well we could not read. The earth would not relent to mere text. Earth as graveyard, earth as road, earth as watering stone, earth as life when leaves sprouted and a goat scampered by and we could eat again. And all you people without skin telling us that love will save us, or that love is everything or anything at all. And why people without skin, you ask? Consider this. If you people had skin, you would feel touch. If you could feel touch, you would understand. If you understood, you would know that love will not be read in the flutter of leaves or the sway of branches, not in the thorny scrub that lay before us endless in the dry season, not in the pale of the sky, not in the ash on our skin, carved out by tracks of urine, because we could not stop for mere relief, not for the cold of small water splashes down our arms from jerry cans that contained life that we could not afford, could not afford, could not afford to let drop, not on your life or mine. If you had skin, you people, you would know that none of this is faith and none of this has anything to do with love. But love kept you alive and prayer brought you back, you say. You who are loved, were loved, speak love, live love, but for our love for you, but for our love for you, but for our love for you, where was love? I want to ask, when fingers were hacked off, lips sliced off, ears torn off, noses broken off from faces, limbs from joints, bodies from life, where was love? Where was prayer when that man was hauled from his bike and killed? And told that his was a lesson that he should not have ridden his bike, not today, not ever. Where was love? And where is your skin? How can you know in these moments that are not born of love, you without skin? Consider this also. Love is not a blanket, it is a cloud. Love is not a blanket, it is a promise of rain, it is torrent, it is the dance in the sky on a hot day, and sometimes love is nothing at all. But it's your own awful emptiness riding across the sky. Consider this also. Prayer as the holy trinity of matter, myth, and meditation. Hail Mary, full of grace. Hail Mary, full of grace. Hail Mary, full of grace. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, pray for us, pray for us, pray for us, pray for us sinners, because you know that my desperate prayer to live would come true. When that man who would end up saving me from drowning was the first sinner among us, who called himself the chosen one, someone who also had someone else say the Hail Mary for. Consider this also, that those of us who knew the love of family, who had family to remember us, who had community and culture and school fees and textbooks, they were among us too. Us without family, no love, no compound of old ones warming in the mid-morning sun, all of us holding on to death on our skin like a curse. We survived and others did not. What love brought us home? Consider this also. The beads that he brought from that market in Khartoum, that one time and asked me to wear it, he said that this was love. He said that these beautiful waist beads were a symbol of love. He said that wearing these beads would mean that I cared for him. He said that this would mean that we would be okay. He said that this war mattered, but that we, our children, us together, mattered more. He said that he would make certain that we would return home. He said that love mattered. He said all this, and I smiling, accepted the beads. Who wants to die of not smiling when a man offers beautiful beads as a gesture of love? And what is this thing beyond a declaration from a place of power? What is love if it's not privilege for those of us who can choose? Thank you.
Wow, really nice. Thank you very much. Yes. That was, I think horror, as I took it, as hate and the absence or promise of like an unfulfilled love. Really beautiful. I loved also the use of repetition in that work. Really nice job. Great. I should mention, just as I hear this beautiful work, it's a tough year for authors. And if anybody watching there wants to Google these writers and pick up their work, read their work, really, really helps us as writers. So, so I think I should just mention that. I also think like at the end of this, before I move on to the next, if anybody has any questions for the panelists, I'll probably leave some time at the end for questions. I think there might be an opportunity to type a question in the chat box. So if you can do that, I'll kind of sift through them, maybe about my time, 3:10. But I think that's 2 hours. I'm 2 hours ahead, so I'm in the future right now. It's interesting, like as you said, Juliane, too, and I'll kind of get into this. It's not really hard to find horror right now, right? Like it's a time of fear that we're living in, and so I'll have to remember this question. But like drawing out fear, how difficult is it, or how easy is it in the time that we're living in? And there's a tendency to kind of to go to the easy fear or to dig a little deeper. But I think I've heard Tin and Juliane have done, dig a little deeper than what might be the obvious horror, which is there's legitimate horror right now. Anyway, so thank you very much. Okay, Selina, let's hear your work.
Thank you also, Tin and Juliane. Those were remarkable. I'm excited to talk a little bit more about them as we move forward. I also have a poem. And I titled it On Horror, very, very appropriate to the theme. And I wrote this also, it's after author and scholar Billy Ray Belcour and also Justin Philip Reed. Both of them are two of my favorite poets and thinkers. And I consulted their work and was reading their work as I was thinking about the piece for this panel. On Horror, after Billy Ray Belcour and Justin Philip Reed. In this episode, I am parts haunting, parts haunted. I smash plates through the ceiling, burn with ancestral fever, shake, coil, sweat, possessed by grief. I light the house on fire, knife the white of my own eyes. The episode wants justification, needs a jar for moral anxiety, for violence, needs to contain the parts of me that refuse to settle. Under the house, a spider web drips mucus and blood, the horror landscapes of every day, colonial naming nailed through the flesh of rivers. I walk through stones, mud, move towards the apocalyptic. I antler and branch, seethe through the porous fabric of time. rattle open the door of possible selves, slip, rupture, glitch between floorboards of grass, dream a bloody keyhole into a lake, into a spine of moons.
Great, thank you, Selina. And when you had messaged me about this and I was looking through, you were talking about addressing this trope of, you know, using the Indian burial site in horror, which is completely overused stereotype. And I think about that too. I mean, I write a lot about representation and the ways in which misrepresentation in popular culture really leads to horrific results for our self-perception as Indigenous people. I think it's even more confusing as those who are walking in two worlds. You know, like I'm half Cree and also half settler. You know, I'm English, Irish, Scottish. So it's a reconciliation with your own identity and coming to terms with that, I think, historical violence that exists within part of who you are. It's and the impacts of it on the other side. Like it's an interesting way to approach this idea of a landscape of horror. Is a really lovely piece. So thank you for that. And last but not least, Sam.
This is totally a case of last is least, but thank you. I don't know how to
Before you start, Sam, let me just say, every writer has that feeling. I'll tell you that right now. Every writer has imposter syndrome, no matter how accomplished you are, no matter what you've done. So you're all good. We're good here. It's I'm looking forward to hearing your piece.
Well, thank you. So this is an excerpt from a longer work about it's about a survivor of a school shooting. And there's no violence in this piece. There's a couple of curse words, but I'm just gonna read a very short excerpt from this. Third period, we're rehearsing in the gym when the boys enter through the side door, coming from the smoke pit. I've put off writing about Gulliver and Steen, and even now I feel I could skate through the rest of my life without painting a fuller picture of those two, one they may not deserve. This is the calculus of writing about the wicked deeds of people you know. Do you hold to propriety and say nothing about them, erase them from the world, leave only the echo of their violence, or risk lingering too long in unhealthy fascination, sensationalizing, which might have been the goal of their actions all along? I find a great deal of true crime repulsive, either pearl-clutchingly virtuous or lurid and glib. It's dishonest to create myths out of damaged, stupid people. And yet whitewashing pain is dishonesty of a different sort. And even this too is dishonest. The writer fretting about how to proceed, chiding themselves for your benefit, performing their anxiety. It's a not so secret way to ask for understanding and sympathy, to alleviate blame, as they wade into violence as remembered, magnified, distorted. The only principle I can hold to is memory, and this is what I remember of them. At first, there's a pack of us, the neighborhood kids, all together all the time, like star material before it separates and cools into constellations. Aid and Shelby and Greg Gulliver and James Steen and myself and a few others. Birthdays, pro D-days, pickup games, creek discovery, and clubhousing. The last generation who are allowed to play outside unsupervised, to roam, as long as they came home in time to wash for dinner. There weren't separate interests, only a general sense of cool. Batman, BMX bikes, video games, monsters. Reading was primarily a venue for discovering creepy shit. Werewolves clawing their way through Maine townsfolk, heroes with stubble uttering swear words and shooting Russian spies, and sex scenes featuring men with names like Seb and Brett conquering quivering womanhood with their engorged members. Any deviance from the group was a point of weakness, My mother had forbidden me from playing with firecrackers, her fear stemming from a cousin of hers who'd lost a finger, or so she claimed, and I was banned from setting them off. On the days someone found or stole a few noisemakers or pyrotechnics, I'd shamefacedly decline my turn to light one off, knowing I was in for a day of being called a ball licker, or fart sniffer, or just so gay. For the others, it was the same. Greg Gulliver couldn't climb trees, so he would wait cross-legged on the pine needle carpet as we called down to him about the treasures we'd discovered up there. Shelby even tried to convince him that we'd found a dead body and were searching the pockets for weaponry and loot. Gulliver pretended he didn't care. He wasn't believable and would once in a while sniffle or scrape a tear off his cheek, but he'd hold to the fantasy of being happy on his own, even in the face of evidence. It didn't save him. Only later did I discover drama and writing, befriend Dylan, fall hard for Riley, and slowly become an individual. But before I coalesced, we were all of one kind, the boys. So when pundits write that Gulliver and Steen were bullied, or that they bullied others, that they did bad things to animals in the forest, that they harbored vague homosexual feelings for each other, that they lied to adults and drank and tried drugs and had a looser than average grasp on reality, that they entertained apocalyptic fantasies. To that, I can only say, yes, they did. And so did all of us. Thank you.
Thanks, Sam. I mean, there is a horror in thinking about the, you know, the awful situations that we see happening, you know, really every day in the States, almost every day in the States with these. And trying to reconcile the fact that how close some people are a step away from committing an act like that. And what I appreciated about that piece was the horror in that the reality that, you know, my dad used to say, we're all human beings. And the people that commit that violence, you know, some I think are going through things that like mental health problems, but oftentimes it's just that they have access and they're mad, and that's scary, right? So I like that in all the, and I also like the, there's a nostalgic aspect to that piece, which I kind of like apart from the horror, and thinking about my childhood and the freedom that we had to just be kids, and how that is so, even pre-pandemic, how restricted our youth have become, and because of the fear. And I think there's horror there too, right? You know, I would never let my daughters go somewhere as Indigenous girls that I would let my sons go, right? And so I think there's also a fear in that kind of helicopter parenting that we need to do now, you know? So I think, anyway, so yeah, there's a lot there that I really appreciated. So thank you for that piece. I like that each of these pieces addressed horror in a different way and drew out horror through own voice, those experiences that we draw, we kind of call from our own cultural backgrounds, life experiences. Like, I think that was very interesting, because I think it would have been easy to look to today and think, let's talk about that horror. And we didn't do that. So I think that, and I think that in an extent is boring to talk about a virus right now, and probably a bit obvious too. So, but there's always kind of exciting ways to do that as well. So thank you everybody for reading your pieces. I loved hearing those. I just, so you know, everybody knows, I hadn't heard them before. So this is the first time hearing of them. So great job. So I just want to get into some discussion questions. And in this kind of in round two, don't feel like there's anybody who has to answer first. Anybody who wants to go. And then, and I would also say that anybody wants to chime in. That's what I like about these panels, is when we get some really good discussions going. And I guess, like, for me, my first question as I kind of think about these pieces is that, you know, usually in writing, we come up with our own ideas, right? So we draw them out from, you know, it might be a prompt, like a headline we read. It might be something that we feel we need to say. It might be somebody we meet. It might be an experience we've had. And I think that there's an element to these pieces that we've done that with. But how is it different, I guess, given the theme that we were provided? Landscapes of horror, as broad as the theme it is. Did that like help or hinder your writing process? You know, having that theme given to you and then really considering the ways in which we usually come up with our ideas for the pieces that we write.
I'll go first because my piece was not, the piece that I shared did not come out from the title, but I have written about horrific experiences before. That particular piece, I said before, it's from a collection called Stories from the Dry Season. And it's a project I began when I began my PhD. I was looking to write the stories of these formerly abducted women from Northern Uganda. And they were painful stories. And it was challenging for me because the war was still going on. The war had just finished. The guns were settled. The trauma was setting in. But I hadn't met these women. And part of my challenge was, how do I write the stories in the voices of these women? I haven't had the experience, but this is people from my background, my home. At the same time, as hearing and reading other people telling these stories in ways that left those women without voice, without power, without any kind of agency. So I knew that even if the situation was horrific, war, kidnapping, sexual abuse, all kinds of things, I would always have to write with the purpose of trying to say that we have a voice, we can tell our own stories, even though I am not the one who went through that experience. So it was really, really tricky. But then I also, because as I'm someone who does not read horror, it gives me nightmares for days. I don't watch horror. I didn't know what to do with the material. And so I found that writing it demanded that I engage in self-care, because stories are powerful and stories represent us, right? We can't think of ourselves without telling a story. But when you're writing stories about horrific situations, you're also defining people's representation in the world. So you have to do it with respect. You have to do it artfully and give it everything you have. Yeah,
there's that representation word again, right? I mean, I heard that in at least three of these pieces, is that this representing self, but representing like a culture, or representing. So that's really interesting. And I think that it also begs a question of, like, what is horror, right? I mean, I think beyond just like, and this is another question, so we can go back to the other question, but like, I think there's two obvious things here. There's looking at the horror of today and what people are going through in the world right now, but also getting away from the obvious tropes of the horror genre, right? So, and no one did that either, I don't think, really. Like, looking at, you know, the horror we see in film or on TV or in literature, everybody found a different sort of horror. And I found that interesting too. Anyway, so getting back to the first question, anybody else wanna take a shot?
I also want to say I'm making a very ugly little basket, and that's why I keep looking down. I can't look on all the time, otherwise I get really tired, so I have to look away. But that's what I'm doing. I'm making an ugly basket, okay?
I love that.
If I look away, I hear my kids.
I love that you're doing, that's wonderful. I should be beating. I didn't think to do that. It's really lovely. Yeah, sometimes looking at the screen, always I will get nervous or something. Always feels funny doing things a bit virtually. Juliane, I love what you said about, yeah, even if a situation is horrific, really paying attention to the power that we have with words and the narratives that we do tell. And that absolutely, as you said, stories represent us. I think about that often in my own work in relationship to time and thinking about time in a Nehiyau worldview is tangled up. And so the past, present, and future are very fluid and always sort of happening at once. And that for me was sort of an entryway into thinking about this prompt in relation to sort of phantoms, and also thinking about, yeah, the huge horror trope, which is, as Dave was mentioning, the Indian burial ground. I'm also like Juliane, I find horror very, I can't, like, as a genre, I can't really watch it. I had an experience when I was in grade 4 watching a horror movie with some friends at like a birthday party or something, and I couldn't sleep. And it just, I know for many folks, horror can be this wonderful sort of realm to escape to. And I think especially when things in our lives feel particularly challenging, I think it can be a genre that allows a venue of escapism. But I'm with Juliane in the way that even that I just, it like heightens my anxiety from things that are hard. And I'm kind of like, I got enough, like, I don't want any more. So that's sort of my perspective. But yeah, approaching this prompt was interesting. I feel like I haven't, I sometimes will exchange prompts with writing friends, and I find it can be really generative or sort of ask me to step outside of maybe things that I keep returning to, or like look at it in a different sort of through a different lens. So for mine, and for writing this piece and thinking about this panel, I did do, sort of as Tin was mentioning, I did do a ton of research, particularly because as sort of a genre, I'm not as familiar. Like I reached out to certain friends who I know who do sort of, I watch horror a little bit more in that world. And so that was really actually sort of wonderful. It felt really good to just kind of engage in scholarship. And again, you know, read some of the work of Billy Ray Balcour and read the poetry of Justin Philip Reed and sort of be thinking about how these tropes of representation in horror and, you know, that settler sort of colonial perspective of being haunted, I think, was really interesting to me. So that was sort of my jumping off point. I can talk a little bit more later about the research and stuff that I did, but I'll leave it there for now. And yeah, I love that question though, thank you.
Thank you, yeah. Sam or Tin? Don't feel pressured to answer if you don't want to. We can just move on to, but.
I do have a few things I wanted to say. Yeah, like I was saying, I did kind of get lost in the research a little bit because at first I found it kind of really difficult to approach the theme, like landscapes of horror, you know, but like kind of moving away from like the mainstream shitty tropes of horror that was kind of, I obviously like didn't want to be on the nose with that. Because like obviously a lot of horror stories or like pieces are always, you know, like based in reality in some way. Like horror doesn't exist in a vacuum, you know. Like I'm sure a lot of horror movies, I don't know, like the Ring, I haven't seen a horror movie in a while, are kind of just like inspired on like, I don't know, the fear of dying alone, whatever. But I'm just thinking, like, this pandemic has kind of forced me to kind of look inward, I guess, about where I'm from. And my heritage in the Philippines, like, I'm part Kapampangan, which is like on my mom's side. And Kapampangan roughly translates to like people on the riverbank, because we're like on the north, on the like north province of the Philippines. And yeah, I don't know, like something about, I'm sure like in a lot of cultures, a lot of like the scary stories that your parents kind of, you know, tell to you are always kind of based on like, oh, like, you know, don't go outside at night. Like basically that's like kind of the gist of a lot of these horror stories, scary stories. I just found myself kind of researching more on like Kapampangan spirituality. And there was so much there that I didn't know about that my own mom hasn't even like kind of shared with me. The title of the poem itself that I wrote means twin soul in my mom's language. And like, that's kind of where I found the inspiration to write this poem based on the landscapes of horror theme. Twin soul meaning like there's like the soul that you're like familiar with, you know, like that you're always aware of, conscious of, and another part of that soul that kind of wanders but is like ultimately attached to the motherland. So like I guess like the latter soul is what I'm referring to in the piece, because like I guess like a personal source of horror for me is kind of to feel like I'm forever, you know, like untethered to where I'm from. Like I'm obviously not on my homelands right now, but yeah, I guess that horror kind of manifests in this like hallucination of like a woman singing like a disembodied voice. But I feel like I'm going off topic a little bit. I can explain a little bit more about what that means, but yeah, no, this was really interesting. Really happy to kind of explore new themes in my poetry. So yeah.
I like that. I like the horror in the unseen. I like that. I mean, you mentioned how a lot of modern horror is shitty. Like the horror that we watch on film, and so much of it is bad. Right, like it's so hard to find a really good scary. I'm on a constant search for scary movies because I never can find them. There's been like three that have scared me in my life, and when they do, it's because the writers or the filmmakers have the patience and also the knowledge that what we don't see is scarier than what we do. Right, what we expect or what we imagine is so much more frightening than what is right in front of us often, depending on what it is. But I mean, and that's why, like, you know, the Blair Witch Project was so scary to me, because you don't see the Blair Witch, you know, it's just like kids banging on a tent, or it's like this guy standing on the corner of a room. Like it's so scary. But yeah, no, I appreciate hearing that. Yeah, and the disembodied kind of, like, that was what's scary to me about your piece, was this disembodied kind of voice that you know, you just, and you don't see it, but it's like, that's very unsettling in a way to kind of have conjure those images in your mind with that work. So, Sam.
Yeah. I want to just make sure my neighbors can't hear me. I'm going to disagree. I fucking love horror. I think it's an awesome genre. I love how much it breaks down the rational part of, you know, the self, and this idea that like, maybe you can't trust your senses. Maybe there's something coming back to you that, you know, from the past that you can't really comprehend or deal with. you know, I always used to think that like werewolf stories were really dumb, but when you really think about the that idea that there's this like rage or anger inside you that's just uncontrollable, I mean, there's something very powerful in these stories. And I love, I think there's a lot of great modern horror movies. I mean, The Witch I thought was great, The Babadook was great, Sinister was dumb fun. I mean, there's a million of them. And I love like Stephen King books and things like that. I mean, some of them are just weirdly resonant. And that idea of, you know, the other thing is like, my girlfriend is the biggest horror reader like on the planet. And for Christmas, I got her, don't tell her, by the way, I got her this collection of reprint horror books from the 80s. This great company called Valancourt Press does a series called Paperbacks from Hell, which are all these old, you know, the monster from Planet X or whatever. Like, just it's really fun stuff. But I think that there's something really interesting when you go from the fun kind of silly horror stuff to something coming out of you or something that actually touches on your life. And, you know, that's the feeling that really gets me. You know, there's a million like bad horror movies about like, you know, slashers and stuff. But, you know, when you watch something like The Exorcist and you're just like watching this teenage girl, you know, something that's like out of control that you can't help. I mean, there's something that that I just find really touching. So I love horror. I can't write horror at all. Like, I would love to be able to write about the supernatural. It's just, you know, there's something about the rational brain that just comes in and inhibits me. So I love watching it and reading it. But, you know, for me, like, I have to write about things that are a little bit more, I won't even say realistic, but just like more externally realistic. So, you know, with something like the piece that I read, I did a high school visit in Olympia, Washington. And, you know, like most people in their 30s, you don't spend a lot of time in high schools unless you teach there. So like, I hadn't been into an American high school in years, and it was so frightening just with the, you know, the metal detectors and guards and stuff. And, you know, I forget that, like, I kind of came of age in the, like, Columbine happened while I was a student. And, you know, that's informed every successive generation of high school students. I mean, just that fear of your classmates. And again, it goes back to horror fiction and that idea of, like, this terror of something that's either outside of you or that's connected to you that's just uncontrollable. And, you know, that was really where my piece came from.
Yeah, fair. I mean, I should clarify. I love horror. I find it hard to find good horror movies. But you mentioned a couple that I love. Babadook, I love. The Witch, I love. Sinister was like had a lot of great jump scares in it. So yeah, but I do find that like there are a lot that I roll my eyes at but those are some that I really, really have enjoyed. Yeah, it's, and the horror you're talking about that you wrote is kind of like, it's almost like an experiential horror, right? Like another form of horror. Like, we've talked about all these different forms of horror. Like, to me, when my daughter went missing for half an hour a few years ago, that was horror for me. Like, you know, we were at the Civic Center here in Winnipeg. It was like this multiplex, and we couldn't find my middle girl for 30 minutes. And, you know, as an Indigenous girl, I thought, is she one of them, right? Is she one of the thousands that have been taken now? And it was like the most terrifying 30 minutes of my life. And so there is legitimate horror in that you could draw on. Now, that I wouldn't be able to do it because it's too close to me, but you can draw on to elicit that sort of fear. And I think part of that writing horror is trying to elicit a fear in people that they can relate to, right? So anyway, so yeah, I think that's a great answer.
I'll bounce off of something, Dave, that you just said, sort of eliciting that fear, and something that I mentioned in my poem about like containing. I do also have this feeling that like certain tropes, especially for me in my piece, like thinking about the Indian burial ground trope, it's a way of containing, or immediately we turn to this like otherness to explain something that's sinister or violent or that you can't explain. And I do think horror, when it's done well, can signal that in a way that is critical, and I think can subvert sometimes. But I do also think, and this is, again, I'm not an expert, I don't watch a ton of it, but it definitely does happen again and again. And I think sometimes, at least with the Indian burial trope, which has been used in like the Simpsons, it's been used in Buffy, it is this way to sort of contain this colonial fantasy about like land dispossession. And there's a term that I came across, which is the Indian uncanny, just essentially for expressing those moral anxieties. And I think, it's like this fantasy of containment. Like, okay, if we can contain these anxieties, then they're not, in some ways it feels like to me, like they're not in the everyday, but they are. And so I think, being very critical of that. And I do think also there's a lot of Indigenous artists and filmmakers and incredible scriptwriters who are working against this trope or working with it to subvert. And that for me is a part of horror that like I'm really intrigued by. Like it did, actually doing my research, I was like, I would be interested to watch these and see what they're doing there. I just wanted to sort of bounce off that idea of containing anxiety. And I do think that is sometimes why people, I don't know. I mean, I can't speak, maybe for those who watch it more frequently, they can sort of speak to containing that anxiety, but yeah.
Well, the Indian burial ground is, I think it's still used. I don't know how often it is used today, but I think it's something that, you know, horror films have returned to again and again and again. And I remember watching a movie called A Ghost Story. I don't know if anybody has seen a movie, A Ghost Story. It's a beautiful film. It's not really a horror movie. It's more of an indie kind of drama, literary kind of ish film. But I remember watching it, and there was one scene, this ghost kind of travels through different periods of time in one area. And he wears a sheet, like literally wears a sheet. So it's very low tech, which is great. And there's a scene where the ghost is in this one place where the settlers are eating a meal or something. And then you hear Indian war cries in the background, and you kind of jump ahead, like probably a day or two in that same area. And then they've all been like scalped and attacked by Indians. You see that like these arrows in them, and you see like, and I thought, come on, you know, can we not, right? So I think about that as you kind of mentioned that, can we not? Like, can we not find different ways, new ideas that don't perpetuate these kind of damaging stereotypes that we see over and over and over and over again, you know? And I've written a lot, like, you know, talking about using that same, you know, trope to subversively knock down or destroy that trope, I think is very interesting. Like that's why I started writing in comics, is because I wanted to use this kind of very tool that has been destructive to be constructive by offering positive representations, where comics have been historically so awful to Indigenous people and how we've been represented. Anyway, so that's just, that I think a lot about that as you kind of bring that up. So thanks for that. Did you find yourself at all, any of you, did you find yourself stepping out of your comfort zones with this assignment, with this commission? Is it something that you tried to, like, I know you did poetry and you wrote poetry. But is it something that you try to do as an artist in general? kind of trying to challenge yourself, step outside your comfort zone? And is it something that in presenting with this theme, and I know that a lot of you haven't written in horror before, did you find yourself stretching, you know, your skill set or your interests in what you typically write? And then I guess like what guided the decision as to the form or the topic that you were going to write in? And maybe you can touch a little bit on the research aspect of it as well, because you, a couple of you mentioned that and how that played into that that process.
Well, I did think about the extent to which I would want to be comforting the reader and not scaring them or horrifying them or pointing the finger back at them. So the extent to which I pushed myself was in my own containment. So I'm hearing about, you know, articulations of moral anxieties and the role of horror movies and the horror genre as spaces where people, readers, audiences can see those anxieties being articulated. But there's also the comfort of the movie or the credits rolling or turning over the last page and you know it's done. But for too many of us, there are no credits rolling, right? And I remember first when I watched The Birds, I think Hitchcock, was it Hitchcock, The Birds, The Crows, right? For me, when that movie finished and I looked out and there were crows, I could not stop thinking about that movie. It did end until I started to develop a different relationship with crows, which they taught me because they hated my ex and they would always attack him. So I started to think, oh, okay, maybe they're my people. So I stopped being afraid of them. So now I'm not afraid of them. But then also to think about Dracula, which I was a TA for a woman who taught Dracula as a story of colonialism, right? And so it was never a horror that ended when it closed the page, it still continued. And to live as a Black woman in these days, in this place, and hear about folks enjoying horror, for me, it's almost, I know that it's them telling me that they enjoy, this is how I hear it, they enjoy it because they don't understand it as an experience, as a lived experience. They understand it as something that can be contained and finished and done with, and they can move on with their life. So David, when you talk about your daughter missing for half an hour, I think to myself, that's not something you could enjoy because that's something that marks you, right? So the enjoyment is in the comfort. So when I was writing my piece, which I decided I could not read because I could not read it. I stretched myself to think that I am not going to write this and get people to feel that, oh, it's done, right? I am going to write about this moment. And I guess the sister piece is the one that's considered this, right? And turn the mirror, so to speak, back at those who feel that this is something that can end. It does not end. It's horrific. And I want to say, as a response to horror, that those of us who live horrific lives, our most important job is to survive it, right? And our next most important job is to be able to talk about it, whether to ourselves or to other people, right? So that's how I pushed myself. And so it's a very angry piece and I have no apologies for that.
Yeah, and you shouldn't have to apologize to it or for it, for sure. Like I totally agree. And I think that part of the difficulty in writing, but also the power in writing, is finding that kind of strength to be able to go there, you know? And then that's where self-care comes in too, right? Like it's very important that if you're going somewhere that is deeply personal, how are you taking care of yourself? I think is maybe a different topic, but I think it's very much related, you know, so. Anybody else want to tackle that one? don't feel like you have to. Okay, well, I'll just remind everybody that if you want to type in any questions for the panelists, I have the chat box open here, and you can throw your questions in there. We have some really nice comments here too, just about how much everybody here appreciated the pieces. How do you as writers find the courage to keep writing when it feels as if your reality and perhaps the reality around you has turned off its lights? In other words, what keeps you motivated to keep writing? Which is a fantastic question. What do you guys think? Anybody?
I'll start. It's a little bit different for me because I work in a genre. Like, I love writing detective stories, and so, you know, I do work in a lot of stuff about Vancouver and its attendant social issues and things like that. But the writing itself is just a joy to me. Like, I love it. It's the part of my day that I have actual control over. So I try to do it, in the morning. And, you know, it can be tough, and it can be tough when the words don't come and all that kind of stuff. But, like, I feel like there's such a stereotype in canlit of writing is this, like, terrible process. And it's like, you know, it's like you're, like, you know, whipping yourself or something. And it's like writing is the best part of, it's the best thing to do. It's the most fun. It can be agonizing, and dealing with the writing business, the publishing business, can be really, you know, talk about landscape of horror. But, I love it. And I don't think the pandemic has, it's made it a lot harder. You know, if anyone here who lives in a small apartment and who's had to fight for space with their loved one or their work, I mean, it's difficult, but, you know, the writing itself is a joy. And, you know, I feel like it makes my life so much better just to do it. So it's, you know, writing is kind of self-care to me, but that's just my experience. So.
I'm gonna try to, like, work off that one, because do you feel that writing is cathartic for you? Like, I know that when I read that question, I think because we have at least three panelists here, not to single out Sam at all, but like three panelists here from marginalized communities, you know, marginalized groups, and I know that for me as a writer, it's. What motivates me to keep writing is knowing that there's still work to do, to either share truths or to, you know, to inform people about things that they may not understand or acknowledge. And I feel like doing that is cathartic, but it's also taxing, as much as I love writing. Do either of you three, being from marginalized communities, you know, I know that Tin from, from what I understand, is from the LGBTQIA community, and also from a diverse cultural background, and Juliane and Selina. How do you feel about that question? And is that something you've tried to do with your work, is address, you know, some of these more weighted and dark subjects that, you know, need to be addressed, but is that something that is hard to keep going? What motivates you to keep going in your work?
I'll go. I have the extreme privilege right now of being a writer in residence. So I get paid to do it, and it's really, really awesome. And SFU is treating me very well. and paying me pretty well too. So some days it's just, I got to get up and write and get paid, right? And there's no complaining about that. But the responsibilities as a writer of color, as a Black woman, as an African, as a Chole woman, as an African in the diaspora, it means that I will always have people who are like, yeah, that's not real, right? Because they feel that either my writing is not representing them, or that it should be representing them and I'm not doing it properly or whatever. So I might not have the freedom. I don't often feel like I have the freedom to write whatever I want to write, because as you said, David, you said three of us are from marginalized communities, right? So it's almost feels as if writing from the margins, right? But I look to people like Toni Morrison, who said, you know, you don't need to write to the center, you write for your community. So if you center your own community as the center of the world, then you don't have to worry too much. My challenge is that I have a very small center of the world. I have a very small world to center, right? But I write and I enjoy writing because I suck at just about everything else I do outside of teaching, and I can only write, that's it. So I might as well enjoy doing it. And I don't worry too much about writer's block, because people call it writer's block, but I just call it marination, right? It just means it's working its way out, and when it's ready, it will come. I don't write every day. It's a good job to have if it's a job or a calling. I like it. I enjoy it.
Selina or Tim, do you want to give it a shot?
Yeah. What keeps me motivated to keep writing? I don't know, because of like pandemic anxieties, I've had to like really slow myself down. Firstly, because I used to work customer service full time and I also like perform quite regularly. So I used to have all this adrenaline that I'm not getting anymore. I have all this downtime now that I'm unemployed, basically. So I've had a lot of creative blocks, but I just kind of let it happen. I feel like that's really important for me right now, especially as someone who's like sick all the time. For me, it's just kind of really important to like accept that I don't need to be saying anything right now. So I do kind of schedule time in, like at least once a week, I'll write for at least an hour and see if anything comes. But yeah, right, I don't know, right now I'm just like turning to other people's works, like other people's poetry, kind of engaging in more escapist forms of entertainment, which just means I've been playing a lot of video games. So yeah, I don't know, personally, I'm not super worried about, you know, like getting a big message out from the margins or whatever. I'm just, yeah, I guess self-care is my priority right now as a writer. Because more will come, like, I'll come up with more stuff later, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting to bounce off of what you're saying. I agree with that in the sense, I've been thinking about like, we are in this moment of collective grief. And I know for me, like my own writing practice, though, you know, obviously I do think about the communities that I'm writing towards, specifically like folks who are white and also Indigenous. That's primarily, I mean, that's the community that I have in mind when I am often writing. I was saying to a friend on the phone the other day, I just said, I just feel small right now. And I feel like now is like, when I'm working, it just feels, and it's not in a, and I don't mean this in a negative way, it's sort of as Tin is saying, like there will be time, but we're kind of in it right now in this collective grief. And I don't know, I wish I was, honestly, I've been thinking a lot about fantasy and sci-fi, because those are genres I actually really love to read. And I've been thinking a lot more about, once I'm done this book, the current book project I'm doing, I would really love to explore that a little bit more. And not that, again, you ever escape, but it would be sort of I'm thinking like it would be fun to kind of have like a narrative that I can kind of step into as opposed to my poetry, which is primarily autobiographical. And that's been really hard. I've been having a really rough time with my mental health. And so exactly as Tim was saying, just sort of, and everyone just being, I think, gentle and kind to ourselves and allowing for time to just, you know, weave or bead. I've been doing a lot of beading, which has been really, just has been a really grounding thing for me to do and to work on. Yeah, I don't know. It's tough. It is tough right now for me anyway, I'm finding. Yeah, but it feels like impossible to have conversations without sort of talking about the pandemic at all. I know, Dave, you started with, well, we won't, but it's a part of working right now. So we're in this like collective moment of grief. Yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think it's like fair to talk about it. And I think sometimes it's a little healing to feel seen and acknowledged that there are a lot of people going through, you know, mental health struggles, and just so like you feel a little seen as well. So, you know, I'll tell you that it's been a really tough couple months for me. I'm sure that some of the laryngitis problems I've had has been because of antidepressants I started. So it's been it's been a really tough year. So just so you know that I'm going through stuff too. And I think that will, there's an end to it. But it doesn't make it easier some days to know that. So yeah, definitely. So let's, I do think that, and I saw in the comments too, it is really good to mention the need to practice self-care. I suck at it, but I think that we need to find ways to take care of ourselves as much as we take care of others. And it's a really good message to kind of start wrapping things up on is, you know, maybe it's writing. You know, for me, I actually, it's funny that you mentioned fantasy, Selina, because I'm in the middle of writing a middle grade fantasy series, and it actually has been a good escape where I can just write about this like other world and imagine that I'm not on Earth for a little bit, which is kind of, you know, it's kind of nice to be able to do that. You know, you kind of, your mind can kind of float away for an hour that you're writing before you have to kind of come back and, you know, see the coronavirus count for the day. But yeah, it's good. So finding ways to take care of yourself, I think, is great. So I'm glad you mentioned that. Yeah, you're not alone for sure. So we have about 13 minutes left. I don't think we have to take up the whole time, but I don't know if I missed any questions, but if anybody wants to put in, oh, here's a question for the panel right here, just right on cue. Do we feel like the collective horror of the world at the moment prevents one from writing about horror? I guess like any other types of horror, or does it help? So I guess in specifically for this commissioned piece, did that help at all? You know, going through what we're going through right now and being able to draw out the kind of emotions and struggles that a lot of people are experiencing.
For me, it helped for sure. I'm just trying to scroll through to see if I can find my copy of it so I could read it, even though I said I wouldn't read it. But it helped for sure to be able to sit down and try and articulate how this is. This goes beyond people's well-intentioned Black Square Tuesdays or whatever it was people was, and institutional statements. Yeah, it was very helpful. Thank you.
Anybody else?
I was just gonna say, I think, you know, we are talking about the pandemic and this idea of collective horror, but there's also obviously, I think that's one particular example, but, you know, obviously also Dave, you were talking about, you know, losing your daughter, and there are like horrors also beyond this pandemic that have been going on since time and millennia, and white supremacy and all that, you know, all that joyful stuff. So I think, yeah, exactly. There are so many different kinds of horror happening right now. And I think, you know, what we've accomplished is sort of expand those definitions aside from kind of the slasher, like gothic thing. But for me, has it helped? The collective horror of the world at the moment prevents one from writing about horror? Does it help? Yeah, I mean, I think it just, I don't know. It depends for me, I think. It was definitely like interesting to approach the topic for me and get to do like research and that kind of thing. I don't know, to be honest, I am finding writing just really hard in general. So that's just me being transparent about that. And so to write this was challenging. I was like, okay, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna try. And I did, and I got something out of me. So that was like, I was like, okay, whew.
Did the deadline help? I assume you had a deadline to get this done by. Did that help you guys to have like a deadline that you have to write this piece for here? I find deadlines help for me. Did it help for you?
Yeah, deadlines are helpful. I still struggled, but yeah, no, definitely. And I have a current like a book deadline right now, so I also have to force myself to do that. And it's hard because a lot of the content of this book, it's not from the past, but it's from a moment that we aren't in right now. So it does feel very hard having to dive into like edits and stuff and keep having to sort of lift myself into a different self or like a different version of self than I am right now. So, but yeah, mm-hmm. Deadlines definitely do help.
What about everybody else? Did you find it kind of helped you to have a deadline to get these pieces finished by, or did you feel like, oh God, how am I gonna get this done by this date?
I definitely needed a deadline. I just like always need that light. What is it saying? Fire under my ass? I don't know. What I'm saying is like, it definitely helped. And also in terms of, Sydney's question, like, do we feel like the collective horror of the world prevents one from writing about horror? I think it will help, you know, like, I'm going to be processing for a while. Like, it's like me processing all the feelings about the collective horror of the world right now will probably take just as long as however it takes them to make a vaccine for COVID. I was just thinking, like, I feel like I've seen so many instances of like mutual aid since like the beginning of the pandemic. And like, I don't know, that made me think like, I wonder if someone's finally gonna write like, or maybe it's already written like a zombie story or like a movie that's not based on like survival of the fittest and is more like a mutual aid kind of thing. I don't know why that just came to mind, but yeah, I don't know, it does help in a way to know that we're all in this together.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. It does help to know that everyone's going through the same thing for sure. And everyone's waiting for this vaccine. That's also for sure. You know, I find like I have a book deadline for July, which is still a ways off, but it's about a guy, you know, going through depression, and I'm like, I can do that. So, you know, that kind of helps. But what about you, Sam?
I found this has been very helpful, and I just wanted to say thank you to Andrea McPherson for inviting me to contribute. And I mean, this has been, it's been great. And the deadline has been a part of that. You know, even before the pandemic, I've personally kind of had a sense of feeling a little bit adrift with things. And the pandemic has definitely accelerated that. And also just made me kind of think like, okay, what are the things that you can actually control, like about your writing or your career or your life? Like what are the things that you're just kind of, you know, waiting for to happen? What's actually within your purview? And, you know, having a piece like this to write has been great, because there are days when it's just really tough to work, and you have other anxieties going on and worried about loved ones. So just having this thing that you have to do and push through has been really great. So yeah, so thank you.
Well, let me, before we finish, let me just ask you one more thing. Is Zoom horrifying? You know, it's funny because you think about like this new phrase this year of "you're on mute" is a very common thing to do, or just how I froze earlier. You know, I've done like probably about 35 to 40 Zoom things this fall, and it can be, as much as it's more comfortable the more you do it, it can be a pretty scary platform to be on. have you all done a lot of Zoom, and are you getting comfortable with it, or? You don't have to answer it.
I teach for a living, but also been invited to Zooms and things like logging in the wrong link. But when I started at the beginning of term, having attended Zoom, I'd never hosted one. So I had people in the waiting room. I didn't even know there was a waiting room. I didn't know how to bring them all in. But there's also Zooms on Saturdays when you think, I should be in bed. But anyway, it's nothing to complain about. It's all good. And we get to see, attend things that we would never have had been able to. So I appreciate that.
Well, I see that. Selina, go ahead before we wrap up.
Oh, I was just going to say, I have a confession. Zoom for me, yeah, it does feel very like, I think because it's so intimate, like I have roommates, so I'm in my bedroom. And before this, I was like moving things around, being, okay, there's nothing, like I'm, you know, I had like clothes around and stuff, and I'm like shuffling things around. So if you saw my floor, it would be pretty funny. But yeah, I think that like intimacy of having someone directly in your space sometimes makes me nervous or more nervous.
Yeah, I'm in my pajamas right now. So, yeah, I want to thank you all for being on the panel. I would just encourage everybody who's watching to make sure to go and look for the work of, Sam and Selina and Juliane and Tin, support and writers in the work that they're doing. And thanks to Andrea for inviting me to be the moderator and for getting these great artists out to take part in the festival. And Echo Zanny, and I'll throw it to you, Andrea, I guess, to wrap things up.
Thank you so much for all of you, Sam, Tim, Selina, Juliane, and David, for this panel. It was a great panel. And I think talking about the pandemic, though we're probably all tired of talking about it, we're all still stuck in it. And your discussion of self-care and being kind to yourself, I think, is really important and great for our students who are watching, because they need to be kind to themselves. Kind of message for you to give as writers in the world who are dealing with all the things that we're trying to be kind with ourselves about. So thank you so much for being here today. I hope you have a great rest of your weekend, and maybe, as Juliane said, restful back Saturday, back in lounging mode after this. So thank you again for being here. Our next panel coming up is going to be Unsaid, which will happen at 1:45 for anyone who would like to attend that one as well. But thank you again to our first panel for the day for making it a great one.